Welcome everybody to Webinar Wednesday, sponsored by the American Oil Chemist Society. My name is Silvana Martini and I will be your moderator. I'm pleased to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Veronique Gibbon, who will talk about designing specialty fats through fractionation and interesterification. Dr. Veronique Gibbon graduated from the University of Namur in Belgium, where she earned a PhD in chemistry with an emphasis in physical chemistry and crystallography in 1984. Her thesis was related to the study of crystallization properties of palm oil. She started her career as an assistant professor at the University of Namur, where she was in charge of several research projects related to fat crystallization. In 1995, she was hired as an R&D manager by the Belgian company Fractionnement Titrois, and later moved in 2005 to the R&D center of Desmet Balestra Group in Belgium, where she was recently appointed as a science manager. Her main area of expertise is fat modification involving fractionation, interesterification, and hydrogenation. Since 2010, she has been a scientific collaborator at the University of Gembloux in the Department of Food Science and Formulation. From 2009 to 2014, she was a member of the scientific committee of ITERG. She is the author of 56 scientific publications, and she has been member of AOCS from the start of her career. Before I hand the microphone over to Veronique, I have a few housekeeping items to cover. Just remember that participants will be muted remotely, but they will be able to ask questions using the chat tool at the right side of the screen. We will have a designated Q&A time at the end of the presentations where Dr. Veronique Gibbon will be happy to answer those questions. With any further ado, I'd like to turn the time over to Dr. Veronique Gibbon. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Silvana Martini, for this introduction. And many thanks to the AOCS for allowing me to make this webinar. It is with great pleasure that I'm here today to talk about the use of fractionation and interesterification for designing specialty fats. With the increasing consumption of cacao butter-based confectionery foods worldwide, the demand for cacao butter is far exceeding its availability, with high prices as direct result. In order to overcome the shortage, but also to improve the physical properties of some cacao butter sources, the confectionery industry is looking for alternatives to replace cacao butter in their recipe or to improve cacao butter melting properties. These cacao butter alternatives are known as specialty fats and are typically used in extensive range of food products. Cacao butter alternatives are designed, in fact, to resemble the functional properties of cacao butter, and there are three types: the cacao butter replacers, the cacao butter equivalent, and the cacao butter substitute. Let's start with the cacao butter. Cacao butter is generally recognized as a model confectionery fat for the edible oil industry. Being hard and brittle at room temperature, but quickly melting at body temperature, cacao butter exhibits exceptional physical properties. The reason why cacao butter is such a desired steep melting confectionery fat is that it contains a high level of one type of triglyceride, the monounsaturated ones with oleic in SN2 and palmitic or stearic in SN1 and 3, SOS, POS, and POP. Since triglycerides largely determine the melting profile of the fat, this uniform composition is reflected through the very sharp melting profile. This rapid melting at body temperature gives the desired cooling sensation and most feel for chocolate. However, cocoa butter quality is subject to seasonal and regional differences. A South American butter is generally softer than a Malaysian one, and an African butter shows intermediate properties. Chocolate manufacturers prefer to have a constant quality output, and for this reason, they use only limited sources of cacao butter to reduce the variability in chocolate quality. Softer varieties are often blended with harder in order to preserve the consistent quality. The cacao butter replacers. Cacao butter replacer-based chocolate were long time considered as the best economical alternative to real cacao butter-based chocolate. The main sources of cacao butter replacers are palm, soybean, and rapeseed oils. CBR are non-tempering fats, and they have partial compatibility with cacao butter. The appreciated functionality of cacao butter replacers is due to the presence of high levels of trans fatty acids, which are now being decried for public health reasons. To overcome this, cacao butter replacers with lower trans content are also being developed. The cacao butter equivalents. A real chocolate is made using cacao butter only, or cacao butter blended with a maximum of 5% of cacao butter equivalent, this in accordance with the European legislation. Due to their particular composition, they may contain high amounts of SOS, POS, and POP. Cacao butter equivalent are fully compatible with cacao butter. Cacao butter equivalent can be customized by a proper selection of their constitutive ingredients, hard palm meat fraction, shea butter stearin, ilipe butter, sulfate stearin, cocum, and mango kernel. Apart from a reduction in fat cost, the main advantages of adding cacao butter equivalent is to improve the physical properties of the fat fraction in the chocolate. The amount of cacao butter equivalent that can be incorporated into a cacao butter equivalent-based chocolate is a flexible parameter allowing producers to make chocolate products with minimum amount of cacao butter. And when the melting profile of the cacao butter equivalent is well above the cacao butter profile, it becomes a cacao butter improver. Cacao butter equivalents are blends of exotic fats mainly containing SOS and POS triglycerides in various proportions, the S2O source, and a fraction of palm oil, the hard palm meat fraction, particularly enriched in POP, the P2O source. It is not necessary, even not possible, to obtain identical composition as cacao butter. Blending hard palm meat fraction with shea butter or sulfate stearin only approximates the cacao butter composition. Addition of ilipe butter, which contains POP, brings a bit of POP, brings the composition closer but not identical to cacao butter. It is mostly necessary to mimic the cacao butter behavior and having a similar tempering. Modified composition can be desirable to deliberately change the properties of cacao butter. And like I said, in this case, the cacao butter becomes an improver. Different kinds of cacao butter equivalent can be designed by varying the types of exotic fats and the relative proportions of hard palm meat fraction. This will give different contents in POP, POS, and SOS, and therefore different solid fat melting profiles of the cacao butter equivalent. In this example, CBA1 is customized based on a blend of shea butter stearin and tart palm meat fraction, but ilipe butter and sulfat stearin, for example, can also be used as it is shown in the table for CBA2, CBA3, and CBA4. The cacao butter substitutes. Cacao butter substitute based chocolate are the most widely consumed of the three. A CBS based chocolate doesn't require special tempering. The main sources of CBS are palm kernel and coconut stearin. Due to shorter chain triglyceride, lauric and myristic types, the compatibility of cacao butter substitute with cacao butter is very low. Commercially available cacao butter substitute are usually post-hydrogenated, fully or partially, depending on their application, but of course, the latter is progressively abandoned in favor of the trans-free version. From a processing point of view, all vegetable fats used in these applications are mostly fractionated, ideally with a dry, optionally with a solvent processes, interesterified using regio-specific enzymes, possibly hardened, preferably with full hydrogenation, in order to match the product specifications. The purpose of this presentation is to give an overview of the various products that can be obtained through the fractionation and interesterification processes, considering the latest technological developments. This is a general overview of edible oil processing, which comprises preparation of the seeds, oil extraction from the seeds or from the fruits, and oil refining with the different steps necessary to remove all impurities from the crude oil. The refined oil may undergo several post-treatments, allowing to modify its melting properties and to extend its applications in food formulation. These modifications are known as being fractionation, interesterification, and hydrogenation. In another stream, the refined oil can also enter the oleochemical processes. Fractionation consists in the separation of high and low melting fractions by selective crystallization, and this can be done by solvent, detergent, or dry fractionation. Apart from some exceptions that will be discussed during this presentation, majority of the edible oils are today fractionated by using the dry process. Interesterification allows to modify the position of the acyl groups on the glycerol. This can be by using a chemical or an enzyme as reaction catalysts. The enzymatic process is by far the most eco-friendly process, which also allows to preserve the oil quality. The degree of unsaturation of the acyl groups can be reduced by hydrogenation. However, today, partial hydrogenation is almost banned in majority of the countries due to the health issues of the trans fatty acids. And in the coming years, full hydrogenation could also become an issue. Fractionation in general and fractionation for specialty fats in particular is divided into stages. A crystallization stage that can be conducted in dry, in the bulk, or in solvent, after dilution in acetone or eventually in hexane. And a separation stage, among which the membrane press filter is today the most suitable technology. In dry fractionation, the crystallization can be operated in static mode or under shear, depending on the characteristics of the oil to be processed. In solvent fractionation, the crystallization is conducted at typical ratios, being, for example, 1-3-0, 1-4 oil solvent, and the slurry is filtered through vacuum filter, a belt filter. Fractionation in practice, and first the case of cacao butter. Fractionation of cacao butter can be done dry or in solvent, often in acetone. When conducted in dry conditions and under shear, the crystal slurry viscosity rapidly increases, which obliges an early filtration. The triglyceride composition of serine and olein fractions and the operation yield are far below acetone fractionation, which allows improved enrichment of SOS and POS in the serine and an operation yield above 50%. However, when dry static crystallization is applied to cacao butter, crystallization can be carried out over the viscosity limits, allowing a more powerful demixing of SOS, POS, and POP, as shown in the next slide by the solid fat content profile of the corresponding stearin, which is getting close to the solvent fractionation. Indeed, this slide shows the solid fat content profile using the UPAC parallel temperate method of three types of cacao butter stearin fractions. In blue, a stearin obtained after dry fractionation under shear. In red, a stearin from acetone fractionation with its very steep melting profile between 30 and 35 degrees centigrade. In dotted red, a stearin from dry fractionation in static mode obtained with the Statolider technology. With a similar yield, the melting properties of this dry stearin are very close to the one of a solvent stearin. The cacao butter replacers. Good cacao butter replacers can be obtained by dry fractionation of partially hydrogenated soft oils. This can easily be done using dry fractionation under shear. In double stage, when starting, for example, from partially hydrogenated soybean oil, the second stearin fraction has the properties of a good cacao butter replacer with a steep melting profile, but a high content in trans isomers. Unfortunately, the recent price reduction regulations make this type of product less and less desirable. The cacao butter equivalents. The hard palmate fraction is a source of POP, like I said, in the fabrication of cacao butter equivalents. The hard palmate fraction comes from the multi-stage fractionation of refined palm oil. Palm oil fractionation makes it possible to cover a wide range of food products. The first two steps are easily completed by dry fractionation under shear. However, when it comes to concentrating POP in the hard palmate fraction, an important viscosity develops from a certain threshold, forcing to turn for the last step to alternative technologies like the static fractionation or the solvent fractionation. This is the multi-step dry fractionation scheme of fully refined palm oil. In function of their melting properties, the fractions can be used in a large range of fat food applications. Like I said, the two first steps corresponding to the palm stearin, the palm olein, the palm super olein, the super stearin, the soft stearin, and the soft palmate fraction can easily be conducted using dry fractionation under shear. However, production of the heart palmate fraction is more delicate and will need alternative technologies like dry fractionation in static mode or solvent fractionation. In solvent fractionation, acetone is generally preferred due to less energy consumption and better product quality. Indeed, the symmetrical triglycerides tend to more selectively crystallize in acetone compared to the non-symmetrical ones. And furthermore, diglycerides being more soluble in acetone than in hexane will concentrate in the middle olein, allowing a better reduction in the heart palmate fraction. However, today, high-grade heart palmate fraction can also be obtained using static crystallization in this last step of fractionation. With a dry static technology, compositional and thermal properties of the heart palmate fraction tend to largely approach what the acetone process can do. And the quality parameters of some heart palmate fraction are reported on this slide. On the left, what the acetone process can do, and on the right, what the static dry fractionation technology can do. Qualities are slightly different, but very close. A heart palmate fraction having a POP content largely above 65%, even 67%, and an iodine value around 33 can easily be produced by using the dry static technology. This slide shows the solid fat content profiles using the UPAC parallel temperate method of the same heart palmate fractions. The solid lines correspond to the two heart palmate fractions obtained from acetone fractionation, and the dotted lines correspond to the two heart palmate fractions obtained by static dry fractionation. The profiles are very similar, with a steep decrease between 25 and 35 degrees centigrade. However, due to slightly different compositional properties of the two types, the solid fat content profile are slightly different, slightly lower at 30 degrees centigrade and higher at 35 degrees centigrade for the dry heart palmate fraction. The shea butter stearin is one of the SOS sources in the fabrication of the cacao butter equivalent. For high grades, dry fractionation is difficult, and the solvent technology is to date still preferred. Due to high latent heat released from the crystallization of SOS, dry crystallization is often not manageable, no matter what the crystallizer's design. Using the acetone process has three advantages: a better crystallization heat dissipation under diluted conditions, possible adjustment of the diglyceride level in the stearin, possible upstream removal of the keratin by precipitation in the solvent. Indeed, shea butter contains 4 to 5% of keratin, which has an impact on the crystallization properties of the shea butter stearin and is undesired for edible applications. The quality parameters of two shea butter stearin obtained by solvent fractionation after keratin removal are reported on this slide. These are two qualities obtained with acetone fractionation. On the left, a high-grade shea butter stearin having an SOS content of 76% and an iodine value of 31. This slide shows the solid fat content profiles using the UPAC parallel temperate method of the same two shea butter stearins obtained by acetone fractionation after keratin removal. Both have a very steep melting profile between 35 and 40 degrees centigrade. The harder shea butter stearin is the highest grade from previous slide, which contains 76% of SOS. Let's discuss now the case of cacao butter substitute. Cacao butter substitutes, mainly derived from palm kernel oil and coconut oils, are particularly enriched in lauric and myristic fatty acids. However, coconut oil has lower iodine value compared to palm kernel oil due to slightly different composition. Both palm kernel oil and coconut oils can be fractionated, screwed, semi-refined, or fully refined. Palm kernel oil, for palm kernel oil, static dry fractionation is the best technology for consistent production in one single stage of palm kernel stearin, iodine value 7, which can be used as cacao butter substitute after full hydrogenation. And let's call it CBS1. A double stage route permits the production of non-hydrogenated high quality CBS2, having an iodine value below 5. This non-hydrogenated palm kernel stearin has outstanding melting and crystallization properties compared to the traditional single stage fully hydrogenated stearin fraction. An increase in total stearin yield can be achieved due to a successful refractionation of the corresponding palm kernel olein into a next palm kernel stearin iodine value 7. And after full hydrogenation, this palm kernel stearin has the characteristics of an excellent cacao butter substitute, also a little softer. Let's call it CBS3. This is the single-stage dry fractionation scheme of palm kernel oil with crystallization in static mode. CBS1, which is the fully hydrogenated palm kernel stearin iodine value 7, can be considered as being a cacao butter substitute of highest grade. Next is the double stage dry fractionation scheme of palm kernel oil using dry crystallization in static mode. A palm kernel stearin with an iodine value below 5 can firstly be produced and used as such as non-hydrogenated cacao butter substitute, CBS2. When the palm kernel olein is refractionated and the second stearin of iodine value 7 is fully hydrogenated, a third type of cacao butter substitute can be obtained, the cacao butter 3. For coconut oil, it is possible to obtain in one single stage with static dry fractionation stearin with iodine values varying between 2 and 5, which is lower than a typical palm kernel stearin. However, the corresponding solid fat content profiles are softer, essentially at 30 degrees centigrade, and this cannot really be improved after full post-hydrogenation. For this reason, the coconut oil is less suitable feedstock for use in normal substitute chocolate coatings. The quality parameters of the three cacao butter substitutes that we called CBS1, CBS2, and CBS3 in the previous slide, obtained from single and double stage dry static fractionation of palm kernel oil are reported on this slide. Remind that CBS2 is a non-hydrogenated product. All these fractions are particularly enriched in lauric and myristic type. However, the coconut stearin contains more shorter chain fatty acids and less lauric acid, and is therefore definitely a softer product. This slide shows the solid fat content profiles using the UPAC cereal non-temperate method of the 3 CBS 1, 2, and 3 obtained by static dry fractionation and eventually post-hydrogenated. They all have a very steep melting profile between 25 and 35 degrees centigrade, and it is interesting to note that the non-hydrogenated CBS2 has a solid fat content well above 55% at 30 degrees centigrade, higher than the value typically obtained for the high-grade CBS1. The content of CBS3 is, however, somewhat below, but still around 40%. Specialty fats can also be designed by using the enzymatic interesterification technology. The principle of interesterification is to exchange fatty acids between different triglyceride molecules on the glycerol backbone. Two types of catalysts can be used, a chemical or an enzyme. And there are at least two types of interesterification processes: random interesterification and regiospecific interesterification. Interesterification for specialty fats is using SN13 regiospecific enzymatic interesterification. In practice, the feed oil flows continuously through interconnected packed bed reactors filled with immobilized enzyme. The fatty acid exchange takes place at the oil enzyme interface where the active sites are located. In enzymatic interesterification for cacao butter equivalents, the objective is to fabricate high SOS, POS, eventually POP fats, starting from selected vegetable oils. The enzymatic reaction is, in reality, the first stage of a multi-step process comprising the enzymatic reaction, which is called interesterification, when it consists in the reaction between two oils or between an oil and fatty esters, or acidolysis when it consists in the reaction between an oil and fatty acids. A stripping or distillation to remove esters or acids in excess. And a post-fractionation to further enrich the final product in SOS, POS, and eventually POP. From a process point of view, drawbacks are the limited enzyme lifetime and reactivity, and the high cost of the enzyme, which needs to be SN13 specific. And the stripping distillation, preferably conducted at low pressure and temperature to minimize SN2 palmitic stearic acid acyl migration and to preserve symmetrical configuration, forcing to turn to alternative technologies like, for example, the short path distillation. This example concerns the acidolysis reaction between a high oleic oil and stearic acid mixed in a ratio 1:1 using an SN13 specific immobilized enzyme. The final product after acidolysis is significantly enriched in STUST triglycerides, with a limited increase in POS, a huge increase in SOS, and a slight increase in SSS. However, the POP content is not modified. The excess of fatty acids is removed by post-distillation, like I said, preferably using short-pass distillation in order to preserve the regiospecificity of the exchange fatty acids. Post-fractionation is then applied, possibly in solvent, in order to improve the compositional properties of the enzymatically modified oil and to allow its use as a high SOS ingredient for cacao butter equivalents. The next example also concerns the acidolysis reaction between a soft palmitate fraction and stearic acid mixed in a ratio 1:1 using an SN1-3 specific immobilized enzyme. The POP-POS-SOS balance is largely improved in this case in the final product after acidolysis, with a decrease in POP, a huge increase in POS and in SOS, and a slight increase in SSS. The excess of fatty acids is also removed by post-distillation, preferably again using short pass distillation in order to preserve the regiospecificity of the exchange fatty acids. The final product may be used as such as cacao butter equivalent or blended with other types. Before concluding, I would like to show this graph tending to point the increasing investment and operation cost as function of the desired cacao butter equivalent quality, highlighting the higher process complexity of the enzymatic process for designing cacao butter equivalent. To conclude, cacao butter alternatives are mostly formulated from fractionated tropical fats, properly selected based on their final applications. In general, the current tendency is to avoid trans isomers, the case of CBR. Some are blends of typical fractions in variable proportions, the CBA. Some are post hydrogenated, CBS1, CBS3, and some can be used as such without post hydrogenation, CBS2. Remind that CBA are fully miscible with cacao butter, also CBS have a limited solubility with cacao butter. The fractionation technology has evolved in the last decade so that majority of these products are palmitate fraction, palm kernel stearin, coconut stearin, but also cacao butter stearin can today be obtained using static dry fractionation. The shea butter stearin is nevertheless a more delicate product for which solvent fractionation remains more suitable. Another developed approach is the lipase catalyzed production of cacao butter equivalent, the enzymatic process that we just discussed, leading to structure lipids with high amount of symmetrical SOS. However, this is a more complex route, which is still quite costly today, and also, I didn't say it, but also submitted to some regulations restricting its use in some countries. I thank you very much for your attention, and I'm ready for questions if they are.
Thank you, Veronique, for this very comprehensive presentation. We will now open the webinar for some questions. So remember, if you have any questions, you can write those questions in the chat space. It should be on the right of your screen. There is a little window that says chat. So we'll wait here for a couple of seconds and see if anybody has any questions. Meanwhile, I have a couple of questions for you, Veronique, if you don't mind.
Yes.
So you showed some fractionation of cocoa butter. What mm-hmm. is the main application? What does the stearin fraction of cocoa butter is used usually?
Like I said in I don't know if you can still see the slides or not. Yeah. Like I said in one of the first slides. I will go to the cacao butter case. That's a question of variability of the composition of the cacao butter depending on the country and depending on the season. In order to have a constant solid fat content profile, it might be interesting to blend softer varieties with cacao butter stearins.
Great.
This is one of the possible applications. There are also other applications, but this is one of the main to maintain a constant quality to the cacao butter melting profile.
Perfect. Thank you. So we have a couple of questions that are coming up. Guillermo Abad is asking if you have the triacylglycerol composition of mango kernel fat.
Mm-hmm.
Can you briefly explain more or less what's that composition?
What is your question? What is the composition of the? I don't have those compositions here with me, but you can easily find it on internet. They are all product rich in SOS and POS. That's why they are used as cacao butter equivalent. But the most used are, in principle, the shea butter stearin, the sulfat stearin, and the ilipe butter.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. We have another question. It says, in dry fractionation of cocoa butter, what causes it that static fractionation makes a stearin with a steeper melting profile than shear fractionation?
Why? The question is why?
Yeah, why is when you do dry fractionation of cocoa butter, why that the static fractionation makes a stearin with a steeper melting profile than the shear one?
Okay, I will go to the this slide. Hmm? In fact, this is simply due to the fact that if you push the crystallization too far, let's say, you will have some viscosity developing in your system. So, in dry fractionation under shear, you need to have a low viscosity slurry in order to bring your crystallized oil to the membrane press filter. It has been shown that in dry fractionation under shear, at the moment you start to crystallize too much POP, SOS and POS, you really develop too high viscosity, not making possible to go further in crystallization and to feed your membrane press filter with the crystallized oil. In fact, this stearin, like you see in the melting profile, is very rich in trisaturated triglycerides. This is a stearin with, if I remember, more than 20% of trisaturated triglycerides. Also, the POP, SOS, and POS contents are very similar to the ones of the cacao butter.
Okay. Thank you, Veronique. We have a few more questions. So, there, Mr. Food, he asked, What is the previous method for making cocoa butter substitute? And he also asks, what is the advantage of using the statolizer to the previous methods?
Previous method for cacao butter substitutes were mostly the solvent fractionation, and in dry fractionation, it was a panning and pressing technology, which is now abundant due to the fact it was high labor, high energy consumption, and so on. And that's why this statolizer technology has been developed, and the statolizer technology is nothing else than a highly automated panning and pressing technology. For the lauric fat, you really need a static fractionation because, again, you will develop high viscosity due to high amounts of saturated triglycerides, short-chain saturated triglycerides. And it is the same explanation as for the cacao butter. When you have too high viscosity, in this case, it is due to the crystallization of saturated triglycerides. In the case of cacao butter, it is due to the crystallization of SOS. When you have too high viscosity, you cannot process the crystallization, or difficultly process the crystallization under shear. The dry static fractionation is really the solution.
Okay, thank you very much. That makes sense. So there's another question here. If you remove the carotene, is it still difficult to dry fractionate shea butter? If so, why?
It is still difficult, yes, yes. It is still difficult if we remove the carotene. For several reasons. One reason is that you have a huge instability regarding to the initiation, regarding to the crystal nucleation, and you still have a huge heat release due to the crystallization of the SOS triglyceride types. And this is really, really difficult. That's the problem. And we have tried already different ways, and we are still continuing in working on that. But we have to say that today, if you want to have a high grade palm kernel, a high grade shea butter stearin, you will need to go for the solvent process. But we never know. We are still working on it.
Great. Thank you very much. Another question. What would be the best filtration pressure for getting higher percentage of POP?
Okay, I didn't mention it, but when you are dealing with special products like cacao butter equivalent and cacao butter substitute, you will need to apply 30 bar squeezing pressure in the membrane press filter.
Okay.
Usually, in the normal cases, the squeezing pressure is limited to 15 bar. And it means also that it has a consequence on the price of the membrane press filter.
Okay, great. There's a question that there's a question about slide 23. The participant asks, we can see in slide 23 that it is possible to obtain HPMF only in two steps. What about the topping? I guess it means what about the other fraction?
Ah, that's indeed here one possibility. It's a slide 23 where I have indicated the full fractionation tree of the palm oil. That's indeed possible to make hard palmate fraction in another route. This route shows that it's possible to valorize all the other fraction for other applications. Is it a question? Did I answer properly?
I think so. I think, yeah, it makes sense. Yeah.
Hello. Filtration pressure. I see a question coming on the screen. Yes.
Yeah, there's a follow-up question about the filtration pressure. It says filtration pressure 15 bars for the first filter and 30 bar for the second?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Usually yes, but I have to say that in some application for the super stearin on the left, the super stearin may also require. Are you still here?
Yes, we're here.
Hello.
Yes, we're here.
Yes, because I think I lost the connection, isn't it?
Can you still see my
slides?
Yes, we can.
Ah, I cannot. So I continue. So what I said is you may need for the super stearin on the left, you may also need a 30 bar membrane press filter. But the 30 bar membrane press filter is really dedicated to special products.
Okay. Any other questions from the audience, from the participants? We have another question. What is the best usage of a palm kernel olein with an iodine value of 27 coming from a multi-stage fractionation?
Okay, that's an unusual question because in this process, the palm kernel olein can be viewed as a low value product. I have to say that today we have seen that this palm kernel olein as such, or possibly full hydrogenated, can be used in the formulation of low trans margarine by chemical or enzymatic interesterification. This can be an ingredient as such, or possibly fully hydrogenated for low trans margarine and shortenings. This is one of the applications.
Great. Thank you very much. It says there's a question about whether the enzymatic acidolysis that you've shown is either on batch or in continuous mode.
I don't know. It is developed for continuous mode. It is developed for continuous mode. It is in fact using the same kind of fixed bed interconnected reactors as used in the production of low trans margarine commodities fats for by enzymatic random interesterification. Yes, it's mostly today a continuous process.
So is there any advantage or a disadvantage of using batch versus continuous?
So there are indeed there are advantages of using of conducting enzymatic interesterification in continuous mode on fixed bed technology, which is mostly linked to the economy of the process. You will have a longer lifetime for the enzyme if you are using a continuous setup.
Perfect. Makes sense. A couple more questions. We have time for maybe one or two more questions. There's a question that says, can we use palm stearine with an IV of 33 to 37 as a biscuit shortening?
You are talking about, I have to go back to the multi. Are you talking about the stearin of the single step fractionation of the palm oil?
I'm not sure. I think so really at a palm stearin with an iodine value between 33 and
Yes,
30.
he says yes. There are in fact several applications, several possible applications for this palm stearin. The one that is proposed might be one of them. I have to say that today we have seen that this palm stearin can be used as the hard stock blended with soft oils for the formulation of low trans margarines again by using the interesterification process. But there are several applications for this palm stearin in the fat food formulation.
Great. Great. One more question. This is for char melting point at 38 degrees Celsius and high solid fat content. I guess we can use that this type of
There is, in fact, a huge difference between a palm stearin and a cacao butter equivalent or cacao butter substitute or cacao butter replacer or what else. The palm stearin contains a lot of trisaturated triglycerides, and its melting profile doesn't allow to have a material which will be melted at 38 degrees centigrade as such.
Yes. Any more questions? We have probably time for one short question. Okay, if there's no more questions, I think we're going to this seminar has come to an end. And we thank you, everybody. We thank Dr. Veronique Bond for this wonderful presentation. We thank the participants for with the very interesting questions that they had. And we hope we see you again in the next Wednesday webinar. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you to everybody for being here this evening, and maybe see you another time.
Bye-bye.
Bye bye.
Thank you.